Dracula is the most famous vampire novel of all time. It was first unleashed on a terrified public in 1897, the year of Queen Victoria's Diamond Jubilee, and the year in which Sigmund Freud began his researches into psychoanalysis. In 1897, the author Bram, or Abraham Stoker, came to the end of a seven-year journey of the mind through a place he'd never visited called Transylvania, the land beyond the forest. On the surface, Bram Stoker was a pillar of late Victorian respectability, an ex-civil servant from Dublin and now manager of a West End theatre, which specialised in spectacular productions of Shakespeare, and where he rubbed shoulders routinely with members of the artistic and political elite. But just below the surface, he had something on his mind. Bram Stoker's terrifying nightmare was a strange brew of three seductive vampires, his own personal hang-ups and repressions, and the witches from Macbeth.
In the moonlight opposite me were three young women. I thought I must be dreaming. There was something about them that made me uneasy. Some longing, and at the same time, some deadly fear. I felt in my heart a wicked, burning desire that they would kiss me with those red lips. I closed my eyes in a languorous ecstasy and waited. Suddenly, I was conscious of the presence of the Count. This man belongs to me.
But above all, Bram Stoker's nightmare was inspired by the literary tradition of the vampire, which had begun some 75 years earlier, here at the Villa Diodati on the shore of Lake Geneva. For in the stormy summer of 1816, two great horror stories had been born. Mary Shelley's Frankenstein and an equally scary contribution from the poet Lord Byron.
On that dismal June evening, after Mary had told her story here in this very room, Lord Byron began a tale about an aristocrat of ancient family called Darvel, who travelled with a young acquaintance to Turkey and died in a graveyard there after promising to come back from the dead 1 month later. And there, the tale tantalisingly ended. But it was resurrected 3 years later by Dr. John William Polidori, Byron's physician, who'd rewritten and embellished it anonymously and without permission under the title The Vampire, a Tale. Lord Byron was furious. From the little acquaintance I have of vampires, he wrote, I have a personal dislike of them. Polidori was in disgrace, and 3 years later, he died, probably a suicide, at the age of 25. The aristocratic vampire had been well and truly launched with the best possible credentials.
Polidori's Vampire was soon adapted as a melodrama in the early 1820s. The Bride of the Isles featured Lord Ruven as a Scottish vampire, complete with kilt and tam o' shanter, causing havoc in the mists of the Highlands.
Phantom from our tomb so drear, at our bidding swift arise!
A visitor to London, who'd come expecting a piece of great literature by Lord Byron, wrote, "The acting was indeed acceptable throughout, but the piece is so stupid and monstrous that it was impossible to sit out the performance."
Arise! Appear! Appear!
I am Ruven. Ruven the vampire, and I come to claim my Bride of the Isles. I must have my fearful sacrifice. I must have my bride, the Lady Margaret, my latest, choicest victim.
The hour has not yet come! Down, down, thou spirit!
To engineer the dramatic disappearance of the vampire, the very first stage trapdoor was used. It's still known in theatrical circles as the Vampire Trap. In 1847, the year Bram Stoker was born, the craze for vampire stories began to spread to a wider public than ever, in the form of a comic or penny dreadful, which came out in weekly parts. Varney the Vampire hugely expanded Polidori's slim tale, and to the basic idea of the bloodsucker, who turns his victims into the undead, introduced two new elements, an Eastern European count and the sexual initiation of the heroine when she's bitten. Just over 40 years later, in 1890, these ideas were picked up by an Irish ex-civil servant who transformed them into Dracula, a novel which synthesized all the elements of the vampire legend from folklore and literature and presented them for the first time in a modern, late Victorian setting. It took 6 years to write his masterpiece, and the whole intriguing process can be reconstructed from his private papers and notes. These were sold at Sotheby's in London in 1913, about a year after the death of the author, and eventually arrived here at the Rosenbach Library in Philadelphia, where they only came to light as recently as the late 1970s. These papers are a unique historical record of Bram Stoker's thought processes and his researches as he prepared his masterpiece, Dracula. And here they are, the complete working notes and papers. They consist of three packets of papers, the first two in Bram Stoker's handwriting, and the third typed on a very early typewriter. And together, they represent the key to the writing of Dracula, because they enable us to piece together, bit by bit, in extraordinary detail, exactly what was on Bram Stoker's mind. They're the documents in the case, which have never been filmed before. And they're documents which are mostly written in the crabbed, pinched, tiny, obsessive handwriting of Bram Stoker on little, tiny bits of notepaper. They begin on the 8th of March, 1890, with that nightmare. Young man goes out, sees girls, one tries to kiss him, not on lips, but throat. And then, 6 days later, on the 14th of March, 1890, Stoker goes back to that nightmare again. Is it a dream? Women stoop to kiss him. Terror of death. Suddenly, Count turns her away. This man belongs to me. We're back to the nightmare again. The papers go on to describe the places he visited, the books he read, and the thoughts he had between March 1890 and February 1896, a six-year project. And the one consistent feature that runs right through the 6 years is that nightmare. To start with, the notes are diffuse and unconnected. No plot, no title, far too many minor characters, no Dracula, no Transylvania. but they begin to come into focus in summer 1890, when Bram Stoker went on his holidays to the little seaside town of Whitby on the northeast coast of England. Whitby was an ancient Yorkshire seaport and centre of such industries as whaling, shipbuilding and sailmaking. Captain Cook learned his craft here. 5 months after he'd experienced his terrifying nightmare, Bram Stoker arrived on holiday in August 1890 and started compiling his detailed notes in earnest. He was joined by his wife Florence and their only child, Noel. A relative said of their marriage that Florence Stoker was a remote sort of person, cursed by her great beauty and the need to maintain it, and that her husband tended to retreat from her into a world of his own. So Stoker spent much of his time on holiday by himself. He talked to sailors and coast guards about the sea and heard a strange story about a Russian schooner called the Dmitri, which 5 years before had run into the harbour in the face of a storm with all sails up, by pure chance avoiding the rocks. Stoker was fascinated and duly stored the story up in his notes for future reference.
Oh, look! What? I thought I saw a ship. There! Oh, yes, I saw it. It's heading straight for the rocks. Oh, how terrible!
The wind suddenly shifted to the northeast and swept the strange schooner before the blast with all sails set. A shudder ran through all who saw her, for lashed to the helm was a corpse with drooping head which swung horribly to and fro at each motion of the ship.
Rainy days, of which there were many, Stoker visited the museum, subscription library and philosophical society, which was crammed full of stuffed curiosities and also had back numbers of the local paper, the Whitby Gazette. And on Saturday, October the 31st, 1885, that's Halloween appropriately enough, they reported that dramatic shipwreck of the Dmitri out of Varna. She ran into the harbour in a force-8 gale, noted Stoker, and she was ballasted with silver sand. But the library wasn't just a place for reading newspapers, it also housed the local literary and philosophical society, which is why it had these two books on its shelves. Now, the first book was a glossary of words from the neighbourhood of Whitby, written by a local chemist called F.K. Robinson. Bram Stoker noted that the local word for devil was bad lad, and that bar guests are terrifying apparitions taking shape, human or animal. But this book was to prove much, much more significant. An account of the principalities of Wallachia and Moldavia by William Wilkinson, Esquire, late British consul resident at Bucharest. On page 19, Bram Stoker jotted down a little piece of information, just for reference, he wasn't certain of its significance. Dracula, wrote Wilkinson, in the Wallachian language, means devil. The Wallachians were at that time, as they are at present, used to give this as a surname to any person who rendered himself conspicuous either by courage, cruel actions, or cunning. Now, Bram Stoker evidently hadn't got a clue what all this was about, but in the fullness of time, this book, with its unprepossessing title, An Account of the Principalities of Wallachia, proved to be Count Dracula's birth certificate. Bram Stoker spent many hours walking through St. Mary's churchyard on the cliffs above the town. Like a civil service clerk with a morbid turn of mind, he carefully noted down 87 names and inscriptions from these graves, complete with footnotes. Thomas Davidson, drowned off the coast of Holland. Cornelius Usherwood, lost at sea. Anne Swales died 6th February 1795. We hope our souls in heaven will dwell at last. It was at Whitby that Stoker first began to plot what was to become the central section of his story, of a vampire from the east who arrives in a deserted schooner, the Demeter, rather than the Dimitri, to colonize the west. Here in St. Mary's, the vampire attacks his first victim on English soil, Lucy Westenra, who will, as a result, become one of the undead.
I could see the seat and the white figure, for I was now close enough to distinguish it even through the spells of shadow. There was undoubtedly something long and black bending over the half-reclining white figure. I called in fright.
Lucy!
For the character of his villain, Stoker needed to look no further than the Lyceum Theatre off the Strand in London. The actor-manager, Henry Irving, was a man he both worshipped and feared. Stoker had been working for him at the Lyceum as business manager, public relations officer, and, as he put it, loyal and devoted servitor for 10 long and grueling years. It was a job which began at breakfast time and ended late in the evening, much of the time in between being spent looking after and flattering Henry Irving's gigantic ego.
Now is the winter of our discontent, the glorious summer,
Sometimes, after the show, Stoker and Irving would have a midnight supper in the beefsteak room behind the stage, here in the Lyceum Theatre, about a century ago. And they'd be joined by artists and public figures of the day, people like Oscar Wilde or the painter James McNeill Whistler. And on one such occasion, they had supper with Hall Caine, a novelist from the Isle of Man, and various other people, to talk about suitable parts for their star performer. And the subject turned to the supernatural. Trouble was that Irving had tried most of the juiciest roles in this area already. The Flying Dutchman, the Wandering Jew, Mephistopheles the Devil. And as Hall Caine recalled, the dominating element in his personality was proving something of a problem where casting was concerned. The parts had to be big with a large slice of ham. Now, it may be that Stoker's relationship with this dominating man, on the one hand, hero worship, and on the other, exploitation, provided him with the central idea for the novel he was working on. Dracula would certainly have been a part which Henry Irving could have got his teeth into.
Bram Stoker had to do much of his writing in hotel bedrooms while on tour with the Lyceum Company or on his annual summer break. Even then, it wasn't uncommon for Henry Irving to summon him back to the Strand at short notice. Every year from 1893 onwards, he chose to take a holiday here on the bleak coastline of northeast Scotland at the little-known fishing village of Port Errol, now Cruden Bay. The locals remembered him as a humourless, preoccupied sort of figure who would shout at the sea when he went for his solitary walks. On his first visit, he fell in love with the place and stayed at the local hotel, the Kilmarnock Arms. Sitting alone in his room and trying to concentrate on a new Lyceum production of Macbeth, Bram Stoker had trouble getting that nightmare of the strong man and his sexy predatory disciples out of his system. In this state of mind, he started the hard slog of drafting Dracula. But Stoker was looking for a big opening for his story. He wandered further north along the Buchan coast and came across Slane's Castle, built in the early 17th century, the residence of the Earls of Errol, which seemed to grow out of the sheer granite rocks. He'd already written of the vampire's dramatic arrival in England. Now he wanted to construct the events which came before the Whitby shipwreck, today the best-known section of the novel. His young hero, the solicitor's clerk, Jonathan Harker, arrives at the home of the vampire count, a vast ruined castle perched on a rock.
Welcome to my house, Mr. Harker. Come freely, go safely.
Count Dracula?
I am Count Dracula. Will you come in? And please, leave here some of the happiness.
Suddenly I became conscious of the fact that I was in the courtyard of a vast ruined castle, from whose tall black windows came no ray of light, and whose broken battlements showed a jagged line against the moonlit sky. I could see even in the dim light that the stone was massively carved, but that the carving had been much worn away by time and weather. I began to rub my eyes and pinch myself to see if I were awake. It all seemed like a horrible nightmare to me. What sort of a place had I come to? What sort of grim adventure was it on which I had embarked?
It was here, in the circular reading room of the British Museum, that Bram Stoker made most of the detailed discoveries which fleshed out his holiday researches. On the very first page of Dracula, he wrote, "Having some time at my disposal in London, I visited the British Museum and made search among the books and maps in the library regarding Transylvania." Exactly what he did. Now, originally, he'd intended to set the book in Styria, part of Austria, but it was reading then-fashionable books such as these which made him change his mind. The Land Beyond the Forest by Emily Gerard, who was the wife of a serving officer in the Austro-Hungarian cavalry, a book which argued that Transylvania might be termed the very land of superstition. Two volumes. And then The Book of Werewolves by the Reverend Sabine Baring Gould, the man who wrote the hymn Onward Christian Soldiers, as well as about 100 books, which had lots of facts and figures about the behaviour of wolves and of people who turned into wolves. "Listen to them, the children of the night," says the Count in the novel. "What music they make." Well, the music came from this book. But the most important discovery that Bram Stoker made in the British Museum was this. A pamphlet published in Bamberg, Germany in 1491, chronicling the campaigns of Vlad Dracula, Vlad IV, with a woodcut portrait on the cover. It told of Dracul's campaigns against the Turks, roughly the same time as Richard III was ruling England. It had nothing to do with vampirism at all. Vlad seems to have preferred impaling or roasting his victims. But this book certainly provided Stoker with the physical description of Count Dracula. It's the face of a military commander rather than a lounge lizard. So it was all these books which persuaded Bram Stoker to set his novel in the Carpathian Mountains in modern-day Romania, even though, while he was preparing Dracula, he personally never went further east than Whitby.
Left Munich at 8:35 p.m. on the 1st of May, arriving at Vienna early the next morning. Should have arrived at 6:46, but the train was an hour late. It seems to me that the further east you go, the more unpunctual are the trains. What ought they to be in China? Beyond the green swelling hills of the Mittelland rose mighty slopes of forest up to the lofty steeps of the Carpathians themselves.
Jonathan Harker's journey was a case of tourism of the mind, based on reading and fantasizing in London rather than first-hand experience in the wilds of Eastern Europe. The details of the journey, from timetables, hotels, even the recipe for chicken paprika, were transposed, sometimes word for word, from printed sources such as Baedeker's Tourist Guide to Hungary and Transylvania, and turned into the Journal of Jonathan Harker.
It was on the dark side of twilight when I finally got to Bistritz, which is a very interesting old place. I felt a strange chill, and a lonely feeling came over me. I waited with a sick feeling of suspense.
Stoker wasn't writing about the real landscape and people of Romania. He preferred an imaginary place where forelock-tugging villagers cross themselves in the foothills of the castle, wolves howl, garlic flowers hang from every door, and the dark Germanic forest is full of things that go snap in the night. Fashionable late 19th century trip to the real Carpathian Mountains as a place where you leave the advanced West and enter the more primitive East. And where, as one of them put it, within this mountain rampart, the whole species of demons, witches and hobgoblins has taken refuge, driven from the rest of Europe by the wand of science. Stoker's novel was laced with ideas from traditional peasant stories, such as those about the Nosferatu, a Romanian word for vampire, told and retold from generation to generation. To Victorian readers who lapped up romantic travellers' tales of Eastern Europe, the villages of the Carpathian Mountains were synonymous with folk tales, or superstitions as they called them, of the dead coming back to life. Of wolves and werewolves, they're the ones who are hairy on the inside. Of the eve of St. George's Day, when all hell broke loose. And most of all, of the vampire, or Nosferatu. Now, these folk tales really grew out of the changing rhythms of agricultural life, the changing seasons of the year, age-old funerary customs, the fear of wolves. And the vampire of folklore was usually a ruddy-faced agricultural labourer with a serious breath problem, for fairly obvious reasons, who was as likely to come back to bite his sheep and cows as he was to molest his relatives. But what the undead actually did when they sank their teeth into their victims' necks seems to have confused everyone. In horror stories, and most of the movies based on them, the vampire uses his upper set of canines, sinks them into the victim's neck, and leaves two telltale marks through which he drinks. But if he'd done that, he'd probably have got his upper set stuck in, and by the time he'd extricated them, the holes would have been very wide apart. In folklore, the vampire uses the upper and lower canines on one side of the mouth, captures a little piece of skin in between, and tears at the flesh like a rodent or a wolf. Now, this skull of a wolf can make the process clear. Now, these little teeth, the incisors, are the teeth which slice. But these bigger teeth, the upper and lower canines, are the teeth which tear. Very nasty indeed. So not only was the vampire of fiction promoted to the upper set of society, he only used his upper set of teeth as well.
But whatever his modus operandi, he was known in this part of the world by two names, and two names only. Nosferatu, or Vampire.
This is the real-life homeland of the 15th century Vlad Dracula, or Vlad the Impaler, whose portrait Stoker had seen on a late medieval pamphlet in the British Museum. His castle was deliberately built to be as difficult as possible for his enemies to reach. In Bram Stoker's version, Dracula is a count who lives in Transylvania. As a matter of historical fact, Vlad was a voivode, or prince, whose ruined castle lies 150 miles south, here in the remote mountains of Wallachia. In the novel, Stoker teased his readers with the admission, "I wasn't able to light on any map giving the exact locality of Castle Dracula." This, the real Castle Dracula, was only identified with certainty 25 years ago, in the early 1970s. Being a satanic majesty, Vlad IV was an orthodox Christian who earned his name Dracula, meaning son of the devil or son of the dragon, in a series of ferocious holy wars against the armies of the Turkish Ottoman Empire. On the walls of this glittering local monastery are portraits of Vlad's successors, the voivodes of Wallachia, who continued the struggle against what were seen as the forces of darkness. Back in England, and back in the novel, after Dracula has arrived by ship, his contagion begins to spread like the plague, and the focus of the story shifts away from Whitby and the Count himself, towards London, Highgate Cemetery, and the problem of how do you get rid of vampires, something with which Stoker seems to have become obsessed. The second half of the novel has various undead predators being staked through the heart with a piece of holy wood and turning back into happy corpses.
In preparing this latter part of his novel, Bram Stoker was inspired by a real-life story he'd heard about the poet Dante Gabriel Rossetti. Now, Rossetti, whom Stoker knew, they'd been close neighbours, was in fact a nephew of Dr. John William Polidori, and he'd buried a little book of love poems in the coffin of his late wife Elizabeth Siddal here in Highgate Cemetery. A splendidly romantic gesture. Seven and a half years later, Rossetti changed his mind and decided to publish his poems. So he got Home Office permission to have the body exhumed and the book retrieved. One night, a fire was built by this graveside. The coffin was raised, the lid was opened, and Rossetti removed the book from the locks of golden hair in which he'd entwined it. Elizabeth Eleanor Siddal was described as perfectly preserved and still beautiful, with a kind of spectral halo about her as she came to light.
For a moment or two, that is. When the book of poems was lifted, some of the red golden hair came away in Rossetti's hands, and the body began to decompose on contact with the air.
But in Bram Stoker's hands, this story turned into something very different. It turned into a way of disposing of Lucy Westenra after she died and returned from the dead as a sexy, full-blooded vampire.
De profundis clamavi et te, Domine, Domine exaudi vocem meam. Fion Torres to intend and it looks perpetual. Lucia dead. It is done.
Having brought together his research notes and jottings for the novel, which itself took the form of jottings and press cuttings and journal and diary entries, Bram Stoker decided at the very last minute to change the title from The Undead, or The Dead Undead, to Dracula. It was published in June 1897, priced 6 shillings, in a stylish yellow and red binding, 3,000 copies. And then, 3 years later, in 1901, it was reissued as a sixpenny paperback in an abridged form with the only illustration that Bram Stoker himself ever authorised. It's the military commander again, this time shinning down the walls of Castle Dracula, looking like an oversized bat with giant webbed feet. Bram Stoker went on to write 7 more novels and 3 works of non-fiction, but none of them came near Dracula in originality, success, or quality.
To protect the theatrical copyright of his novel by turning it into a play, Bram Stoker arranged a semi-dramatized reading on the stage of the Lyceum Theatre just before the book reached the bookshops.
The final scene.
The whole Dracula industry began here, with a show consisting of 5 acts and 47 scenes.
To all of us and from all sides.
A Mr. Jones played Dracula, and it lasted nearly 5 hours. Here, finally, was a chance for Stoker to impress his boss with something he had achieved. But Henry Irving, who listened to the reading, stormed out at the end, declaring in a loud voice that the work was dreadful. His devoted servitor, who desperately wanted to please, must have been crushed.
Which has blighted all our lives.
The same year that Dracula was published, 1897, was the year that Sigmund Freud began his researches into psychoanalysis. And the novel's often been interpreted since then as a parable of repressed sexual desires. One Freudian has called it a kind of incestuous, necrophilious, oral, anal, sadistic, all-in wrestling match, which basically means that anything goes. Others have related it to the Oedipus complex, Dracula as daddy, or to a paranoia about liberated women who quite literally get put back in the box, or to a yearning to break every taboo in the business, especially taboos concerning blood, a case of stop it, I like it. One reason why the novel has remained so popular with adolescents, it's been argued, is because it's about sex from the neck up. Sex without guilt, without responsibility, without pregnancy. Sex which lasts forever. Sex which doesn't even need to be mentioned. Not exactly safe sex, but you can't have everything. Bram Stoker himself would have been absolutely amazed at all this analysis. A great fan of censorship, he once wrote, "The only emotions which in the long run lead to harm are those which arise from the sex impulse." To judge by Count Dracula, too much indulgence leads to hairy palms, a pallid complexion, and very bloodshot eyes. It's likely that Stoker thought of his book as a simple adventure story about a gang of fine upstanding chaps who defend their womenfolk against the nasty Eastern Europeans who would make Britain part of their evil empire. But that, of course, doesn't begin to explain what's made Dracula so very, very popular. Bram Stoker never lived to see the success of Dracula on stage or screen. After his death, Florence Stoker showed how sensible he'd been to try and protect the copyright when in 1922 she attempted to get some form of payment from a German film company for the first version of Dracula called Nosferatu, directed by Friedrich Wilhelm Murnau. The company had adapted the book, changing the names of the characters, but without asking anyone's permission.
So Mrs. Stoker sued, and when the producers went out of business, she got a German court to rule that all copies of Nosferatu be destroyed. Fortunately for us, if not for her, one print survived in Germany. The film is now reckoned to be one of the classics of early cinema. Vampire Count has been transformed from a military commander into a bald-headed, emaciated creature of folklore with the ears of a bat and the fangs of a rat. He's the creature referred to by one critic as a penis with teeth. But it was Hollywood that projected Dracula onto a world stage and made the Count truly immortal.
Watch out! They may be hovering over you. Or you. Or you!
On Valentine's Day 1931, Universal Studios' Dracula, billed as the strangest love story of all, made a superstar of the well-fed, Hungarian-accented Bela Lugosi. He didn't resemble Bram Stoker's description at all, and he had difficulty speaking his lines in the English language, but he made the part his own.
The original terrifying story of a man who lived after death, lived on human blood, took the form of a vampire bat, and lured innocent girls to a fate truly worse than death.
An aristocratic vampire who did his biting in color.
Dracula has appeared in more films than any other character in the literature of horror. Over 200 of them, in fact, and that's not counting cartoons and comedies. And he's still by no means out for the count. As a corporate image, consisting of fangs and cloak and black tie and pallor, the uniform of the lounge lizard, he's appeared on a staggering amount of merchandise, a sure sign that he's entered the bloodstream of modern culture. But he doesn't always bite into the jugular vein these days. There have been vegetarian Draculas. He sometimes prefers just to go around selling things, like sweets, for example. The biter bit. Many an accountant must have said with feeling, "Child of the night, what music you make."
Bram Stoker died in London on the 20th of April 1912, in the same week as the Titanic went down on its maiden voyage to America. He was 64 years old, and his death certificate declared the cause of death to be exhaustion. He was cremated here at Golders Green in North London, where his ashes still remain in a nondescript marble urn.
It had been a quiet funeral, and he left just £4,700. But he left something else as well. He left a story which laid down the ground rules for countless adaptations and sequels and parodies. The ground rules for a whole industry in the 20th century. No one can write a vampire story, or it could be argued, a mass market horror story of any description, without acknowledging the sheer power of Dracula. Today, we can confront the dark themes of Stoker's novel head-on in ways he just couldn't imagine. Dead words like contagion, repression, dependency, sexual initiation, and so on. But we still seem to prefer the metaphor of vampires, the fairy story version. So Dracula has taken on a life of its own and long since flown away from the literary world altogether. The Count has been so successful that he simply won't lie down.
I hereby summon to this place next week
person within the sound of my voice.